my heart goes out to everyone involved with Galway Capital of Culture. What a horrendous, what a fantastic opportunity there was, and a great programme of work that got, you know, completely decimated in terms of the impact by the year it fell in, being the same year as COVID. And we are, you know, in terms of we gave a lot of support to festivals through this year to help them to survive fundamentally. And I think when we're looking into the first half of 2020, you know, it is, you know, festivals take a long time to plan and develop, and an awful lot of work goes into them. You know, and you know, it's more important that festivals survive, so they're there for when they can really happen again. So we're going to be, you know, whereas we don't envisage that, you know, it is, you know, that festivals are going to happen across the first half of next year in the same way as they normally would. We will be giving them some level of funding. It will be reduced, but to help them to survive so they're there for the future. We'll need to look at half two 2020-2021 closer to the time to see how things are spreading as to whether the festivals can happen. But Niall might talk to the kind of the international marketing of them. From Monaghan and Cavan point of view, Cavan is the west part of Cavan is in Ireland's ancient east, and is in Hidden Heartlands, and the eastern part of Cavan is in Ireland's ancient east, as is Monaghan. We've got, and I think that the opportunity that brings, you know, for that area, certainly that is very much on our radar. We'll have Monaghan Town. Unfortunately, it won't complete next year on destination towns. That's going to be a little bit later. That will complete in hopefully in half one 2022. That we will have enhanced the offering of Monaghan Town as a tourism destination, and then, you know, that. We're working with that area in Cavan on the as part of the Hidden Heartlands, and I think, you know, the opportunity there, and the opportunity we also, you know, of linking in with Fermanagh and that whole that whole Cavan Lakes and Marble Arch, that whole area is something that we do think can be developed. The Bear Breffni Way, I think, will be a big addition when we can bring it to life. So that is effectively a continuous walk from Black Lion in Cavan down to the Bear Peninsula. And Cavan will be at one end of that. So I think there's an opportunity for that to drive tourism growth as either a start point or a finish point on that walk.
Well, in terms of the two concepts of the Hidden Heartlands and the Ancient East, was there? Do you think it's been helpful or unhelpful, the fact that the two concepts are kind of split in the county?
I think, look, we tried to, that was something we debated over long and hard as to whether we like to see a county fall into one brand area if we can, because it's simpler engaging with local stakeholders and local authorities and stuff like that. But it's got to kind of make sense when we're presenting it to international visitors and how we show a map and share a map and stuff like that. So I don't think it is in any way harmed tourism development in Cavan. It's just made it a little bit more complicated, and is something that we you know, in terms of we're happy to keep engaged with the local authority and local stakeholders and keep that under review. I think it is important that West Cavan is part of Hidden Heartlands. I think the offering there, the lakes, and that fits in better with the natural outdoors offering of Hidden Heartlands as opposed to the historical based offering of Ireland's Ancient East. So I think that is important, and we are, you know, we'll keep under review kind of that split, and we'll keep engaged with local authorities.
Same theme in terms of the success of the three particular concepts.
The Wild Atlantic Way is obviously, but before the Wild Atlantic Way kind of even was done, that was an area that was, you know, more developed from a tourism point of view, with towns like Galway and Lahinch, the Cliffs of Moher, Kerry, of course, West Cork. So the Wild Atlantic Way has obviously accelerated that, and it has been, and it is the oldest brand. I mean, these brands are all incredibly new by international standards. They are babies, you know, and the Wild Atlantic Way has been incredibly successful. Ireland Ireland's Ancient East has grown, you know, very well in terms of, and has really brought parts like Wexford and Kilkenny have done very well.
In Heartlands?
And yes, but it was more developed to begin with, and it has been around longer. In terms of the start of the Hidden Heartlands, and Jenny might, because she was in charge of and building Ireland's Ancient East, the start in Hidden Heartlands has been a faster start than we had in Ireland's Ancient East. We've had more industry engagement over the first year or so, and it is going incredibly well. Jenny, do you want to just speak to Ireland's Ancient East for a moment from your history?
So just, I suppose, like Paul said, it's just to remember that those brands are really new and they're babies. And I suppose just the other thing is, and Niall will attest to this, but in terms of Wild Atlantic Way, it has a huge resonance with the domestic audience. The Ireland's Ancient East had less resonance with the domestic audience, but actually had huge resonance with the international audience, because when the international audience looks at Ireland, it thinks about that green Ireland with those castles and that culture. So actually what Ireland's Ancient East resonates is really resonates with the US market and with European, like France, etc. So actually Ireland's Ancient East resonates better with the international markets than it does with the domestic. But having said that, that Keep Discovering campaign that we did last year really raised the profile of Ireland's Ancient East domestically, and it is continuing to grow in the domestic market and has great potential, as does the Hidden Heartlands.